We're live.
Okay, at this time, I ask that you place all electronic devices to vibrate. Please turn on your videos. Mr. Public Advocate.
You're muted, Jumani.
I was testing the system. It's working. You notice I'm muting. The bang. Good afternoon and welcome to the stated meeting of August 27th, 2020. I'm Public Advocate Jumani Williams, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to this virtual meeting of the New York City Council. If you'd like to follow along, the agenda for today's meeting is posted on our website.
Please join us for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call.
Adams.
Present.
Epri Samuel.
But I'm here.
Thank you. Ayala.
Present. Sorry.
Thank you. Barron. Borelli.
Present.
Brannon.
I'm here.
Cabrera.
Here.
Chin.
Present.
Cohen.
Here.
Constantinides.
Present.
Cornegy. Deutsch.
Present.
Diaz.
I'm present, just for the record.
Thank you. Diaz. Drum.
Present.
Eugene.
Present.
Gibson. Jonai. Thank you. Grudenchik.
Here.
Holden.
Here.
Kalos. King.
Present.
Thank you. Koo.
Present.
Kozlowitz.
Present.
Lantzman.
Present.
Lander.
Here.
Levin. Levine.
Present.
Somebody tell Borelli we can see he has no pants on.
Lewis.
Present.
Thank you. Mizell. Menchaca.
Presente.
Miller.
Blessed and present.
Barron.
Oh. Unbossed, blessed and present.
Thank you, council member. Miller. Moya.
Present.
Perkins. Powers.
Present.
Reynoso. Richards.
Present.
I'll get some.
Rivera. Rodriguez. Rose.
Present.
Rosenthal.
Here.
Salamanca.
Present.
Torres. Traeger.
Here.
Ulrich.
I am here, present.
Thank you. Vallone.
Here.
Van Bramer.
Here.
Jaeger.
Here.
Matteo.
Here.
Kumbo.
Present.
Speaker Johnson.
I'm here.
Mr. Public Advocate, we have a quorum.
Councilmember Kalos here.
Thank you, Councilmember.
Councilmember Gibson's here.
Good afternoon.
Idanis is here too.
Okay, I have you all. Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much. And I'm here in prayers. I know we all have our prayers still with our majority of the combo. So I just wanted to offer that. We will now have today's invocation, which will be delivered by Ravi Vaidyanatha Shiva Chira, spiritual leader at the Hindu Temple Society of North America, which is located at 4557 Bound Street in Flushing, Queens.
Namaste and good afternoon to all. It's my privilege and honor to lead today's invocation. Dear leaders and members of this council, I offer my sincere prayer to Lord Ganesh for the smooth function of the council and for the benefit of the people. I wish to chant a verse from the holy book Yajurveda Upanishad, which is in Sanskrit language. I will also read the meaning in English for the benefit of all. This month is dedicated to Lord Ganesh, and we celebrate it in our temple for 9 days. Due to the present pandemic situation and restriction in congregation and gatherings in the temple, we live streamed all the rituals and the people prayed safely staying at home. Now the prayer is from Sri Ganapati Atharva Shirsha Upanishad. Om Bhadram Karne Bhishrnayama Deva Bhadram Pashye Makshabhir Ejatra Stirai Rangai Istushtvaghum Sastanobihi Yashema Deva Hitam Yadhayuhu Swastina Indro Vridhasrava Swastina Pusha Vishwaveda Swastina Starksho Arishtanemihi Swastino Brihaspatir Dadhatu Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. O gods, may we hear auspicious words with the ears. While engaged in fire worship, may we see auspicious things with the eyes. While praising the gods with strong limbs, may we enjoy a life that is beautiful and beneficial. May Lord of Gods of ancient fame be auspicious to us. May the supremely all-knowing God of the earth be propitious to us. May the destroyer of evil be well disposed towards us. May preceptor of the God ensures our welfare. May peace prevail everywhere. Peace, peace, and peace. Lord, instruct the leaders in Niti Shastra as Utsaha sahasam dhairyam buddhis shakti parakramaha shadete yatra tishtati tatra devo apitishtati. Leaders who lives with qualities such as enthusiasm, adventure, courage, intelligence, strength, bravery and aggression will always have the support of the Lord and the people. The Niti Shastra, the moral code of conduct. Sarve janaha sukhino bhavantu. May all beings be happy. God bless you. Namaste and thank you.
Thank you so much. And I'd now like to ask Councilmember Koo to spread the invocation on the record.
Thank you, Mr. Proper Advocate. It's my great honor to welcome the director and spiritual leader at the Hindu Temple Society of North America, Mr. Ravi Vaidila Sivarathri. The Hindu Temple Society of North America is a tremendous landmark of my district. The temple is known throughout the world and a large part of what makes my district in Flushing, Queens, a hallmark as the birthplace of religious freedom and diversity in America. Mr. Sivarathri has devoted his life to serving all living beings, and his teachings pull from knowledge, faith, spirituality, and science. His heraldry is one of Hindu priest lineage from southern India, and he has devoted himself as an author, a philosopher, a priest, and a healer. And our community is very proud that he has joined us today to host our city council invocation. Thank you for your blessings and for your service to our city. I make motion to spread the invocation in full upon the record.
Thank you very much. We'll now have the adoption of minutes.
I make a motion that the minutes of the stated meeting of June 30th, 2020 and July 28th, 2020 be adopted as printed.
Messages and papers from the mayor?
None.
Communication from city, county, and borough offices?
None.
Petitions and communication?
None.
Land use call-ups?
M249 and M250.
A coupled on a call-up vote, and at this time, I'd ask the clerk to take a roll call vote on both of today's land use call-ups. Again, this is just a vote on the land use call-ups on today's calendar, not on the bills we're voting on.
Adams.
I vote aye.
Amphrey Samuel.
Aye.
Thank you. Ayala.
Aye.
Darren. Councilmember Barron.
Councilmember Barron, are you there?
I have an unstable connection. I'm sorry. Boss, blessed, present, and I vote aye.
Thank you.
Hope you heard me.
Yes, thank you. Yes.
I'm try to establish another connection. Thank you.
Borelli.
I vote aye. Thank you.
Brannon.
Aye.
Thank you. Cabrera.
I vote aye.
Chin.
I vote aye.
Cohen.
Aye.
Constantinides.
With permission, I'd like to vote on all land use call-ups and all general orders on today's calendar.
Yes.
I vote aye.
Carnegie.
Permission to explain.
Mission granted.
While as a body under the leadership of Speaker Corey Johnson and my friend, we've made tremendous strides in working towards equity in minority communities in New York City. I'll not be voting on any matters before the New York City Council today. As a member of the New York City Council who is a Black man, I've taken my responsibility to my community and to this city seriously. As a member of New York City Council, I've legislated, marched, walked out, sat down, and even laid down on behalf of racial injustice and inequity. The one thing I have not done is leverage my vote and its incredible value to highlight the racial division that exists and continues to conspire to minimize the Black experience in this country. I woke up to more news of police misconduct and acts of violence perpetrated against Black people in this country. I withhold my vote on behalf of Robert E. Cornegie III, who resides in Florida, the Stand Your Ground state. I withhold my vote for Nicholas Cornegie, who lives in one of the most violent sections of Brooklyn. I withhold my vote for Nia Cornegie, who attends an HBCU in North Carolina, for Nyla Cornegie, who attends a self-proclaimed Trump school in Arlington, Virginia, for Noah and Nkosi Cornegie, who attend school in Georgia, one of the characteristically most racist states in the country. I hold my vote for Amadou Diallo, Patrick Dorsman, Tysheen Bourne, Andre Fields, Albertus Frule, Usman Zongo, Timothy Stansberry, Stephon Teron Crawford, Sean Bell, John Collado, Antoine White, Dwayne Brown, Chantel Davis, Kamani Gray, Miriam Carey, Ronald Singleton, Akai Gurley, Jeffrey Ragland, Eric Garner, Miguel Espinal, Felix Kumi, David Felix, Raymond Peralta, Garland Tyree, Dalton Branch, Michael Hanford, Shahid Bassell, Katherine Johnson, Oscar Grant, Ayanna Stanley James, Kenneth Chamberlain, Rakia Boyd, Trayvon Martin, Kendrick McDade, Timothy Russell and Melissa Williams, Kendrick James, Michael Brown, Tamir Rice, Samuel Du Bois, Natasha McKinney, Megan Hockaday, Christian Taylor, Sandra Bland, Freddie Gray, Walter Scott, Alton Sterling, Philando Castile, Corin Gaines, Atiana Jefferson, Pamela Turner, Breonna Taylor, George Floyd, and most recently, not dead, but paralyzed from the waist down, Jacob Blake, thank you.
Deutsch.
Thank you, Councilman.
Aye. Diaz.
Aye.
Drum.
Aye.
Eugene.
Aye.
Gibson.
I vote aye.
Jonai.
With permission, I need to vote on all land use items and on all general orders. And in addition, due to technical difficulties at this morning's Finance Committee vote, my conflicts of interest disclosure may not have been heard and entered into the record. For the record, my wife is a school nurse with the Department of Education, and my sister is an administrator at the Department of Education. And my sons may enroll as students at CUNY.
Permission is now granted.
Thank you.
How do you vote, council member?
I vote aye on all.
Thank you. Gordonchik.
Aye.
Holden.
Aye.
Kalos.
Aye.
King.
Aye.
Koo.
Aye.
Kozlowicz.
Aye.
Lantzman.
Aye.
Lander.
Aye.
Levin.
With appreciation and respect for Councilmember Cornegie, I vote aye.
Levine.
Aye.
Lewis.
Aye.
Mizell. Menchaca.
Permission to explain my vote on the Industry City application being called up today.
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
I represent Sunset Park, a community that spent hundreds of hours analyzing and debating the Industry City rezoning proposal being called up today. It is because of their work that I do not support it. Yet it is being called up today, and the implications are large, not just for my district, but for the entire council. Yesterday, Speaker Johnson said he welcomes debate on the rezoning proposal through the lens of accountability, that we should explore whether legally binding conditions can be found to reap the benefits of a rezoning while mitigating its negative effects. Sunset Park agrees, which is why last year, after launching a working group, after 10 public town halls, numerous letters and petitions, I outlined three specific conditions that would have achieved what the speaker and I seek. Those conditions either failed or cannot be met in the time left on the ULURP clock. Industry cities should use this pandemic and the economic recession as an opportunity to go back to the drawing board and include the community's recommendations in a new application. Instead, they are abandoning the community concerns and ramming through their proposal unchanged. So why should the people's representatives defer to entitled developers? Why should this body ignore what the Sunset Park community achieved after 10 public hearings in multiple languages? Yes, the council will debate the rezoning, but our process only includes one public hearing. And before that public hearing, a handful of colleagues threw their support behind this industry city developers plan without turning to the Sunset Park community to understand the issue. And their message was clear. Sunset Park, your voice does not matter. The voice of your representatives in the federal, state, and in the city council who oppose this project do not matter. Only industry city's lofty promises matter. Promises with no accountability. This massive and historical rezoning is a turning point for us here at the council and this city.
Time.
Does Sunset Park have the power through the representatives to control a public land rezoning procedure? Or have we lost all our power and control to developers? Colleagues, I'm calling on your hearts and minds to listen to our voices and stand with people. I vote aye.
Miller. Moya.
I vote aye.
Perkins. Councilmember Perkins?
I vote aye.
Thank you. Powers?
Aye.
Reynoso?
Permission to explain my vote?
Richie Grant?
I'm at an event with some young people, so I'm gonna ask to vote on all land use call-ups and general orders. But before I do that, I just wanna say that what's happening with Industry City and what's happening with Intro 1942 speaks to how this council, in this council, having a few good lobbyists does a lot more than advocacy out on the streets when it comes to affecting change. I'm going to vote against 1942 because I think it does damage to our environment, and I've been fighting for environmental justice. I voted in Transportation Committee against the bill put forth by Idanis Rodriguez, because I think we should be doing something more comprehensive, not necessarily something that moves the needle, but I think we can do both. So I'm gonna vote yes on all other items except 1942, which I think is just moving forward because of lobbyists and not necessarily something that's been called for by the environmental justice community. Thank you.
Richards.
This is just land use call-up items, right?
Yes.
All right, vote aye. 1-0.
Rivera.
Aye.
Rodriguez. Rose.
With appreciation for Councilmember Carnegie's position, I vote aye.
Rosenthal.
With gratitude to Councilmember Carnegie, I vote aye.
Salamanca.
I vote aye.
Torres. Council Member Torres, your microphone.
I think we lost him.
Okay. Council Member Traeger.
Aye.
Ulrich.
I vote aye.
Vallone.
Aye.
Van Bramer.
Permission to briefly explain my vote?
Commissioner Grant?
Yes.
Thank you. I just want to say that I stand with Councilmember Menchaca, and I know how hard he has worked with his community that he knows best, because he's lived there and represented that community for the last nearly 7 years in the New York City Council. And I will stand with him today. I will stand with him when we ultimately vote on this. With that being said, I vote yes.
Jaeger.
Aye.
Thank you. Mario.
Aye.
Combo.
I vote okay. Aye.
Okay.
Thank you. Councilmember Torres?
Richie.
Speaker Johnson.
Richie, your mic's not on. Okay, I vote aye.
Today's land use call-ups have a vote of 45 in the affirmative, 0 in the negative, and no abstention.
Thank you. Today's land use call-ups are adopted. We will now have communications from Speaker Johnson.
Good afternoon, everyone. Happy Thursday. I hope you and your families are safe and well. This continues to, of course, be a difficult time for all New Yorkers as we continue the fight the devastating health and economic impacts of the coronavirus pandemic. I speak to New Yorkers all the time who are fighting through losing a loved one or their job as a result of this terrible disease. We are suffering from so much pain right now in our city. But I have also been inspired by the ingenuity of my fellow New Yorkers. As we go around the city, we see more and more creative examples of outdoor dining. Having those kind of outlets to eat and safely catch up with friends and family has brought some renewed energy and excitement to our streets. Likewise, parents of our 1.1 million public school children have been wondering how their children can safely return to school if it is unsafe for adults to be indoors in the same conditions. Our selfless educators are wondering whether returning to school is safe for them, particularly those in at-risk categories. To all of those students, parents, and educators, we hear you. And that is why the chair of our education committee, Councilmember Mark Traeger, and I called upon the mayor this week to allow for classes to be conducted outdoors. And Councilmember Traeger put forward a great plan about a month ago, saying how we could get back to school. The mayor has put forward a preliminary plan for some outdoor education. The details of that plan are far from perfect and will take an enormous amount of effort to refine, but I think it's important that we try to keep moving forward in a way that provides safety for our children and educators and people that work in our schools. By working together, New York City will rebound. New York has always been the greatest city in the world, and it is my pleasure to serve as speaker of this New York City Council. As we continue our efforts to stop the spread of COVID-19, I want to take a moment to remember the lives that have been lost. As of yesterday, we lost 22,669 New Yorkers to this terrible virus. That number includes probable deaths. This number includes many of our civil servants who were committed to serving the people of New York. Those who are currently battling the virus and those who have lost loved ones to this terrible virus continue to be in all of our prayers collectively. I also want to take time to mention those our city has lost to 9/11 related illnesses since we last met. The NYPD lost a veteran detective, Edward Grozinski, who succumbed to his illness yesterday. He was 49 years old. The NYPD also lost a retired sergeant, David Yu, and officers Robert J. Meradian and Dennis J. Howard. The FDNY lost firefighter John P. Fogarty, who passed away on August 25th to his illness. I also want to acknowledge the passing of a former Queensborough president, the indomitable Claire Shulman. I had the privilege of getting to know Claire, and I will miss her dearly, her invaluable leadership and her love for New York's largest borough is irreplaceable. My heart is with her loved ones, especially her children, during this time of mourning. I also want to send my deepest condolences to Councilmember Fernando Cabrera, who lost his mother, Iris Quintana. And I also want to send our condolences to former Speaker of the City Council, Christine Quinn, who lost her father recently, Lawrence Quinn. I know that Councilmember Cumbo lost a loved one as well recently. I want us to take a moment of silence for all those New Yorkers we've lost to COVID-19, Claire Shulman, Iris Quintana, Lawrence Quinn, as well as firefighter Fogarty, Detective Gorinsky, Sergeant Yu, and officers Meridian and Howard, if we may now observe a moment of silence. And I believe we also have lost former Assemblywoman Nettie Mayerson, and I want to make sure that we include her in this moment of silence as well. Thank you. On Sunday, another unarmed Black man was shot by a police officer in Kenosha, Wisconsin. Jacob Blake was shot 7 times in the back as he entered his car where his 3 young sons waited for him. The pain that Jacob and his family are coping with is unimaginable. To quote Jacob's father, quote, 7 times, like he didn't matter, but my son matters. He's a human being and he matters. The American legacy, horrible legacy, of systemic racism must end because the life of Jacob Blake and all of those that Councilmember Cornegie mentioned earlier matters, because the lives of his sons matter. Those boys deserve to grow up in a country where they don't have to fear getting shot in the back by people who took an oath to protect them. Sadly, we have been here before, over and over and over again. We cannot allow the frequency of these terrible acts to numb us. Instead, each of these acts must strengthen our resolve for change. We must never forget the Black women and men who we've lost to police violence and their families who have been left with a lifetime of grief and fear. We can do better, we must do better, we will work to do better. And I want to thank Councilmember Cornegie for his incredibly moving words earlier. Yesterday marked an important anniversary in our country. We commemorated the 100th anniversary since the 19th Amendment was adopted in the United States. I and every New Yorker remain grateful to the trailblazers of the women's suffrage movement for their tireless effort and commitment to justice. But it's a stark reminder that while women were granted the right to vote through this adoption, not all were. Black and Latina women continued to face suppression and exercising this essential right that remains the cornerstone of our democracy. I also want to acknowledge 2 incredible staff members who are leaving the council, Alana Sivan and Alex Washington. Alana has been an instrumental member of our criminal justice team, specifically during our effort to close Rikers Island. Alex has been a vital member of our transportation committee, recently working to legalize e-bikes and e-scooters throughout the city. New Yorkers are better for the work that Alana and Alex have done, and the council is immensely grateful to you for your work. We all wish you the the both. We all wish you both the best on your next journey. Last but not least, we are keeping the people of Texas and Louisiana in our prayers as Hurricane Laura has made landfall in their states overnight with devastating consequences. Now, moving on to our agenda, we'll be voting to approve the following land use items with modifications: Grant Avenue and Pacific Street rezoning in Majority Leader Lori Cumbo's district will facilitate the development of a 9-story mixed-use building with 64 units, including 16 affordable units, and the 52nd Street rezoning in Councilmember Jimmy Van Bramer's district, which will facilitate the development of an 8-story mixed-use building with 61 units, including 15 affordable units. On today's stated agenda, the council will be voting on one technology-related bill, proposed introduction number 1297A, sponsored by Councilman Richie Torres, which will codify the Office of Cyber Command into the city charter. The office was initially created in 2017 by Mayor de Blasio's executive order number 28. Codifying the office will ensure the existence of the office, which among other things establishes and regularly updates cybersecurity policies and standards for city agencies, trains city employees in cybersecurity policies and standards, and directs cybersecurity defense and response. And I want to thank from the staff, Irene Bohofsky, for her work on that bill. The next bill is a housing and buildings bill. The COVID-19 pandemic has made it difficult for many construction workers to complete the site safety training courses required to obtain a full site safety training card by the current compliance deadline of September 1st, 2020. This bill, sponsored by Public Advocate Jumani Williams and Councilmember Carlos Menchaca, introduction number 2059A, will provide additional time for compliance by extending this deadline to March 1st, 2021. And I want to thank Austin Branford for the staff for his work on this. The next bill is proposed introduction 1865A, sponsored by Councilmember Idanis Rodriguez, which will create a task force to study the challenges and viability of delivery and black car industries and make recommendations for legislation to address these challenges. Among other issues, the task force would study the impacts of advertising on for-hire vehicles and its potential as an additional revenue source for for-hire vehicle drivers. I want to thank from the staff, Elliot Lynn. Next, the council will be voting on a series of bills related to environmental protection. These bills are all co-sponsored by Councilmember Costa Constantinides. The proposed introduction number 1982A will require that for the purposes of greenhouse gas emission limits, accounting pursuant to Local Law 97 of 2019, fuel cells that are operational before January 1st, 2023 will be credited compared to the electricity grid marginal emissions factor published by the New York State Energy Research and Development Authority. Fuel cells that are operational after July 1st, 2023 will be credited compared to an electricity grid marginal emissions factor decided by a rule by the Department of Buildings. And I want to thank Nicola Ben for her work on that bill. Proposed introduction number 1851 would amend the administrative code, the plumbing code, and the building code as it pertains to construction permits, construction projects intended to reduce the flow of stormwater and waterborne pollutants into sewers that empty directly into the waters of the state or overflow into such waters due to rain or snowmelt events that exceed the capacity of the wastewater treatment plants. As it applies to the municipal separate stormwater sewer system or MS4 projects, this local law will ensure that the rules for such projects are not less stringent than the New York City MS4 permit and the NYSDEC construction general permit. This legislation would help improve water quality throughout our region and move us towards the goal of fishable and swimmable waters. The local law would take effect 180 days after it becomes law. And I want to thank from the staff, Samara Swanston, Nadia Johnson, and Ricky Chawla for their work. Next, proposed introduction number 1946A will require the Department of Buildings to annually distribute information to buildings of all sizes, including those connected to gas lines, regarding making energy efficiency improvements and complying with existing energy regulations. From the staff, I want to thank Jessica Albin and Austin Branford. And finally, the last slate of bills is related to our small businesses and restaurants. Our small businesses and restaurants are the heart and soul of our city, and this pandemic has further exacerbated the issues that they have been facing for a long time. The shutdown has been devastating for them on so many levels. We cannot afford to lose the businesses and restaurants that make New York City, New York City. The bills that we are voting on today will be lifelines for so many of these businesses and restaurants. More is needed to help these vital businesses during this uncertain time, but I'm grateful for the tireless effort that went into making these bills a reality and for the leadership of the council members who sponsored each one of them. The first, introduction number 1958A, sponsored by Councilmember Donovan Richards, will require the Department of Small Business Services to report on each business that received a grant or loan from the New York City Employee Retention Program or New York City Small Business Continuity Loan Fund. Both were created in response to the devastating impact of COVID-19 on small businesses in the city. Reporting would include information on each business's council district, zip code, industry type, including whether the recipient is a mobile business, and the amount of grant or loan received by the business. SBS would submit the report to the mayor and speaker of the council and make the information publicly available on its website. Next, introduction number 1470B, sponsored by Councilmember Mark Levine, will codify the Commercial Lease Assistance Program, which is operated by the Department of Small Business Services. This program offers legal help to small business tenants relating to their lease. SBS would be required to offer pre-litigation legal assistance on lease-related matters, including the drafting and negotiation of lease terms and lease termination issues. In addition, this bill would empower SBS to extend their program to provide legal representation in court so attorneys could assist with tenancy issues, such as filing a notice of appearance in court for small businesses facing a potential eviction. This bill would also require SBS to help small businesses understand and apply for COVID-19 related funding programs. Small business tenants are defined as those with incomes no higher than 500% of federal poverty guidelines who meet size requirements established by the Small Business Administration and who are not chain businesses. The last two bills further the assistance the council has provided to our city's restaurants. Right now, dining is restricted to outdoors or takeout or delivery options. Until restaurants can operate fully indoors, the council will be voting on legislation to lighten the burden they face from high fees charged by third-party delivery platforms like Uber Eats, Seamless, and DoorDash. These restrictions were originally passed in May of this year, and these bills would extend them to continue to provide assistance until indoor dining has fully returned. Introduction number 2043A, sponsored by Councilmember Mark Joni, will prohibit third-party delivery platforms from charging restaurants for telephone orders that did not result in an actual transaction during the call. It would extend Local Law 51 of 2020 so that the prohibition would be in effect as long as restaurants are restricted from operating at maximum indoor capacity plus 90 days thereafter. Finally, introduction number 2054A, sponsored by Councilmember Francisco Moya and Councilmember Mark Joni, would extend the delivery cap fee, Local Law 52 of 2020, for third-party delivery platforms until restaurants can operate at maximum indoor capacity plus an additional 90 days thereafter. The bill also adjusts the fee cap so that third-party delivery platforms may charge restaurants for fees they incur from third parties for processing the customer's transaction. The bill makes clear that a delivery platform may charge a restaurant no more than the actual cost incurred by the platform for processing the transaction. And I want to thank Stephanie Jones for her work on all of these small business bills. With that, I turn it back to you, Mr. Public Advocate.
Thank you so much. Just checking in with the Sergeant of Arms to see if we have any council members who have signed up.
Yes, the Majority Leader, Majority Leader Kumbo has signed up to speak.
Thank you. Majority Leader Kumbo. Majority Leader Kumbo is on mute.
Thank you. You're doing an excellent job.
Trying to make the seat look good when you're not.
Good afternoon. Today, the council will be voting on the Grand and Pacific rezoning in my district. This rezoning will help transform an area of vacant lots and open storage into a vibrant, mixed-income, mixed-use area in Crown Heights. This important action would not have been possible without the tireless advocacy of Brooklyn Community Board 8 over the last 5 years to develop and push for a comprehensive community plan. I submitted a letter on August 24th, 2020, which is now a part of the record for this rezoning, describing the many important aspects of this rezoning. I want to highlight the key points from that letter today. Today's rezoning closely follows the recommendations of Community Board 8 and the Brooklyn Borough President as part of the M Crown Comprehensive Community Plan. First, this modification will reduce the density on the southern side of Pacific Street from R7D to R7A, which will more closely reflect the built character of the buildings in the immediate area around it. Second, the rezoning on the north side of Pacific Street to R7D will help to facilitate transitional density. In keeping with the M Crown plan, R7D on the north side of Pacific Street is down from the future density on Atlantic Avenue. The R7D designation will also allow for important community benefits such as light industrial, arts, or community facility uses. The community board has been pushing so hard for this rezoning because it will be such a benefit for our Crown Heights neighborhood. I want to thank Community Board 8 for all of their hard work. It's exciting to see community boards leading the rezoning process, which is reflective of the visions, goals, and ideals of the people that live directly in the community. And I thank them for their support, as well as their participation in this five-year process. For those reasons, I encourage my colleagues to join me in voting aye in favor of this rezoning. Thank you so much, Public Advocate Jamani Williams.
Thank you, Majority Leader Kumbo. Parliamentarian, do we have any others sign up?
No, Mr. Public Advocate. If there are any other council members who wish to speak on discussion of general orders, please use the raise hand function in Zoom and we can recognize you.
I'll take a moment, a privilege to just speak very briefly. We have a bill coming on that speaker spoke about dealing with construction site safety. I just wanna thank Councilmember Chaka for the work we've been doing on this for the past several years. Knowing that the pandemic has affected everything, we want to make sure the laws were reflective of that. I also wanted to thank Councilmember Cornegy for his words today. It is a rough time, so as I've been saying, I am not okay. This country is actually not okay. I think most people of good conscience are not okay. And I'm pretty sure that most Black folks are in a perpetual state of being close to tears. But they have to continue going to work. They have to continue going and doing whatever they have to do for their lives. And if they show any kind of emotion, depending where they are, there's very negative consequences to that. And it is a very hurtful thing when you see people dying who look like you and people, mothers and fathers crying who look like your mother and father. And people who don't understand that these communities are squeezed and sandwiched between street violence and don't recognize that both of those things are symptomatic of a system that many people are trying to destroy. They are not separate, they are very much linked. And sadly, some people are fighting to keep that system, either consciously or subconsciously, without understanding that that is a system that continues while people are dying. And I've had to watch in the past 3 days, a convention where people are championing this. People are using words like law and order and protecting the American way of life, as if they've magically woken up and found new policies and new ideas, when these are the same words and same ideas that have been used since the beginning of this country to do horrible things to people. I just want to take a moment to say that we're not okay. We know there's going to be another hashtag, and we are at a time where we can either really begin to atone for this or just continue the way we're going. But those people who believe that somehow we want this violence. We want to continue. Somehow we believe that police are not a part of the solution and confuse that when we say we just want accountable policing like any other community. I ask you just think about the pain that we're all in and why. Thank you. Mr. Parliamentarian, do we have anyone else signed up?
We do, Mr. Public Advocate. We have council members Gibson, Rodriguez, and Menchaca.
Councilmember Gibson, followed by Rodriguez and Menchaca.
Thank you so much, Mr. Public Advocate. Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate, and good afternoon, Speaker, and all of my colleagues. I just quickly wanted to take an opportunity to thank all of you for all of the work we're doing in our districts. It's been a very trying time for all of us. I wanted to vote aye on all of today's agenda items and general order calendar items. I wanted to thank our chair, Costa Constantinides, for leading a lot of the efforts around environmental work and environmental justice in the council and in the city. And certainly I wanted to extend my love and my condolences to all of our colleagues, Majority Leader Cumbo, Councilmember Cabrera, and others who have suffered losses of loved ones, stepmother and mother in their own family. We don't always realize, you know, we are hit by not just COVID, but just death in our families as well. And we're feeling it as well. And yet we still find strength to carry on and do our work. And so I want to vote aye on all of today's agenda items and thank my colleagues for all of the bills that were introduced today. And I look forward to our continued work. Thank you so much, Mr. Public Advocate. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Rodriguez.
As a point of parliamentary order, please just hang on the line for a little bit longer. The vote has not opened yet, and we will call on you first to vote as soon as the vote on the general orders calendar opens, but we can't have you vote quite yet during discussion of general orders.
Thank you.
So first of all, thank you, Public Advocate and Speaker. Today I want to talk about the bill that I have been the prime together with other colleagues, which is the one that will create the Libre and Black Card Task Force. This task force is needed because, as everyone knows, a few years ago, we had 50,000 Libre drivers. Today, there's only 10,000 of them. And many of them, they left those bases, Libre bases, because they were offered a lot of opportunity to make a lot of money by Uber and Lyft. However, that promise has not been fulfilled. So the bill that we are voting today will create the task force similar to the Yellow Taxi Medallion Task Force. Hopefully we will get this task force to work immediately. And first of all, for the mayor to sign immediately and for the task force to work so that we can identify different ways on how we can rescue and save the Libre and Black Card and traditional Black Card, a company in the city of New York. Gracias a todos. Hoy vamos a votar por el proyecto de ley que va a crear los Libre y los Black Card Task Force. Thank you.
Councilman Menchaca, thank you, Councilman.
Thank you,
hey, what's going on?
Public Advocate. I want to talk on the bill to extend the deadline for the construction safety training. This is a bill that a public advocate and once upon a time, Councilmember Williams, the last session pushed. What I want to remind everyone is that the incredible solidarity that came within the workers of the city, both union, non-union, and day laborers that came together to put this construction safety requirement, we did it in phases. Right now we need to extend it. And one of the reasons that I want to just point to, the day laborers are telling us that the extension and the ambiguity on the extension, which will be clear today after your vote, will allow that training to happen and for construction companies to follow. They are on the line to really fund a lot of these construction safety protocols. And so those are the kind of things that are
sorry, to ask those who are not speaking.
Hit you. I see you.
If those are not speaking, can you please put the pin on mute? Thanks.
There's a lot of excitement at home. This is going to allow for justice for all our workers who are very vulnerable right now. And I just want to say thank you to all the workers, the union workers, the non-union workers that came together back years ago. While we're extending the deadline, we're committing our efforts to ensure that you're safe. The last thing I want to say is that the Department of Buildings has really recommitted their efforts to ensure that all the information that needs to get out in multiple languages is going to get done. And I believe that. And I also want to speak on the Industry City thing really quick. We have a 10 a.m. Briefing tomorrow that I'll send everyone on email, and everyone's invited to learn more about that process. Thank you, Public Advocate.
Thank you, Councilmember. Mr. Parliamentarian, anyone else signed up?
Yes, Mr. Public Advocate. First, Councilmember Reynoso, though let's clarify whether he'd like to speak on discussion of general orders or if it's to vote.
Councilman Reynoso, is this to speak on orders or to vote?
Yeah, it's to vote. To vote.
We'll call on you at the very beginning of the vote, but this is still a discussion of general orders.
Thank you.
No problem. And then Mr. Public Advocate, Councilmember Ulrich, also would wish to speak.
Okay. Anyone else after him?
No, no one else.
Thank you.
I would just like to vote first, because my battery is running low and I can't get to a charger right now. So the sooner I can vote, the better.
Okay, we will call on you at the beginning of the vote.
Okay, so I believe that is the last council member, unless the parliamentarian tells me something different. And now we have a report of special committees.
None.
Reports of standing committees.
Report of the Committee on Environmental Protection, Intro 1851, Stormwater Management.
Allow me 1 second. Coupled on general orders.
Intros 1946A and 1982A, Energy Efficiency Improvements and Marginal Emissions.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Report of the Committee on Finance, Preconsidered Reso 1394, Transparency Resolution.
Coupled on general orders.
Report of the Committee on Housing and Buildings, and Preconsidered Intro 2059A, Site Safety Training.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Report of the Committee on Small Business, intros 1470B and 1958A, Legal Services and Financial Assistance Reporting for Small Businesses.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Preconsidered intro 2043A and 2054A, Third Party Food Delivery Services and Food Service Establishments.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Report of the Committee on Technology, intro 1297A, Office of Cyber Command.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Report of the Committee on Transportation, intro 1865A, Livery Task Force.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
On the general order calendar, LU 628 and Reso 1411 and LU 629 and Reso 1412, Grand Avenue Rezoning.
Coupled on general orders.
LU 641 and Reso 1413 and LU 642 and Reso 1414, 52nd Street Rezoning.
Coupled to general orders, and at this time, I'm asking the clerk to take a roll call vote on all of the items coupled on today's general order calendar. And Mr. Clark,
Ulrich, excuse me.
We can start with the members that are requested to vote at the beginning.
Councilmember Ulrich.
Councilmember Ulrich, are you there?
We have lost his audio.
Councilmember Ulrich, are you there?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Time to vote.
Okay, I vote aye on all.
Thank you.
Councilmember Ulrich, do you have any disclosures to make?
I wish to just disclose on the record today that we're voting on a number of budget items as part of the initiative funding. And one of the groups that I spot that is receiving funding, the Howard Beach Kiwanis Club, I've been a member of for about 15 years.
Thank you, Councilmember.
Thank you.
Councilmember Reynoso.
Councilmember Reynoso, are you there? Councilmember Reynoso?
Can you hear me? Can you hear me now?
Now we can. Go ahead.
Sorry. I'd like to vote aye on all, with the exception of intro 1982. And that's it. So, which I vote no on.
Thank you. Got it. Councilmember Gibson.
I vote aye on all of today's item agenda. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Kumbo.
I vote aye on all, and I thank all of my colleagues for your notes, letters, prayers, and upliftment during this time of the passing of my stepmother, Fakesha Kumbo. I must excuse myself to attend services today with my family, but I thank you again for all of your support and well wishes and prayers. Thank you so much, and I proudly vote aye on all.
Adams.
I vote aye on all.
Amprey Samuel.
Disclosing on the record of the council proceedings that the Department of Education is funded and my brother is employed as a school teacher with DOE, and I vote aye on all.
Ayala.
Aye on all.
Barron. Councilmember Barron.
Can you please come back to me? I need some information. Thank you.
Sure. You got it. Borelli.
I vote aye on all except intros 2043 and 2054. Thank you.
Thank you.
If you can, I'm ready.
Okay, sure. Councilmember Barron.
I'm ready. This is Council.
Okay. Yes, Councilmember Barron, whenever you're ready to vote. Yes.
Commissioner Granite. Okay.
Thank you. First, I want to extend my condolences to everyone who has suffered a loss, and also to the family of Nettie Meyerson, who sat next to me when I was in the assembly. I want to extend my condolences. And secondly, commendations on the 100th anniversary of the right for white women to vote. Acknowledge that. And in terms of the reopening of schools, I have lots of reservations about that, but I commend Chancellor Carranza for the work that he has done. In terms of the vote, I vote aye on all with the exception of land use. LU 6289, which includes market rate housing. And everybody knows my position on that. And also Bill 1942, which is the project that was spoken about earlier. Thank you very much. And please put me down for general discussion. Thank you.
Councilmember Barron, do you have a disclosure to make on the record?
Yes, thank you. I want to disclose for the record that my son is a member at CUNY, and CUNY is in the resolutions, as well as another son who is an employee at BRIC, and they are also in the resolution.
Brannon.
Yeah, aye on all.
Cabrera.
I'll vote aye on all, and I want to take a moment to thank everyone for your love, for your support. Just burying my mom just literally last Saturday. This last 2 weeks have been the toughest 2 weeks of my life, coupled with my mother-in-law who has stage 4 cancer, very late stage 4 cancer. And so thank you. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for uplifting hope and faith. With that, again, I vote aye.
Chin.
I vote aye, Anoha.
Cohen.
Thank you. Before I vote, I would like to disclose on the record of these proceedings that Montefiore Medical Center is in the resolution today, and that my wife is a voluntary attending at that institution. And with that, I would like to vote aye on all.
Carnegie.
Permission to explain?
Permission granted.
My statement from earlier holds. I hold my vote for the proceedings of this particular meeting of the New York City Council, so I will not be voting.
Deutsch.
Aye and all.
Diaz.
I would like to disclose for the record that two of my children, Ruben Diaz Jr., the Bronx Board of President, and Samuel Diaz, works for New York City. I voted in NYCC. Other than that, I'm voting yes in everything. Thank you very much. Have a good day.
Thank you, sir. Drum.
Aye.
Eugene.
I vote aye.
Gordonchik.
Permission to explain my vote and to talk a bit about the late greats, Claire Shulman and Nettie Mayerson.
Permission granted.
Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate, and thank you, Mr. Speaker. Speaker Johnson mentioned the loss of Claire Shulman and Nettie Mayerson, who I had the privilege not only to work for, both of those great ladies, but also to be mentored by and to become dear friends with. Claire, as many of you know, was the first female woman to be borough president of Queens. She took over at a very dark moment in the state of our great borough of Queens and quickly righted the ship by demanding excellence and bringing good government back to our borough. She changed the face of Queens forever. Her work over almost 16 years as borough president created the modern metropolis that we know as Queens. I think before she was borough president, in many ways, it was seen as a bedroom community, but now it is a thriving center of commerce, and it is known throughout the world as a great place to come and eat food from all over the world. The face of Queens was changed forever by Claire. You can't go to a neighborhood where she did not have an effect, whether it was tens of thousands of school seats, the dozens of cultural facilities that she helped to build, her work with former Mayor David Dinkins to bring the new USTA National Tennis Center to Flushing Meadows Corona Park, the AirTrain, Queens Hospital Center would have closed and would have been shut down, but nobody had the courage to tell Claire Shulman that it was going to be closed. And we have a new hospital, and it continues to improve. SAGE, the first gay senior center, was funded by Claire Shulman, first one in the borough of Queens. And Townsend Harris High School, which stands proudly on the campus of Queens College, also because of Claire's resolute activities. I could go on about her forever, but I know our time is limited. And she and Nettie left us within 72 hours of each other, which is just unbelievable. Both of these great ladies were mentors not only to me, but to the late Assemblyman Mike Szymanowicz, my brother from another mother, soon-to-be Judge Lee Cheng, Justice Bill Viscovich of the Supreme Court. Grace Meng described Claire as a mentor, and on and on and on. And I want to mention Nettie because of her work on the baby AIDS bill in Albany. And Inez, she did love you. She did love you. There's no doubt about that. Because of her work on the baby AIDS bill, thousands of people are walking this earth who would never have made it past infancy without her legislation. She also passed the Partner Notification Act, victim sentencing, which allows victims of their survivors to have a say at sentencing in court. And for all of you who've dragged your mother or your grandmother, your grandfather, your father down to the DMV to get a photo ID, that was the work of Nettie Mayerson a generation ago. Both of them served their respective communities in countless ways. They came up through the PTA, and I was a little boy in the neighborhood. Nettie was the head of my PTA. She was always doing something. I didn't get to know Claire until I went to work for Nettie. And so there was a symbiosis there for me, certainly. Both of these great ladies, as much time as they spent in the community, they were utterly devoted to their families. And I know that other of our colleagues here today, Karen Kozlowitz and Rory Lantzman and Paul Vallone, shared wonderful relationships with both of them as well. I want to give my condolences to their children again, to Larry. Just a few more seconds, Mr. Public Advocate. And to Dr. Larry Shulman and to Ellen Baker and to Jeffrey Mayerson and Judge Lee Mayerson. And I want to just impart one last thing to anybody who might be watching this. And it's a lesson really for all of us. There was never a night that Claire and Nettie left the office before me where they didn't say thank you to me and the rest of the staff. And there's a lesson there. And they both understood. They both understood that the most important things were what their constituents needed and wanted. With that, Mr. Public Advocate, I vote aye on all. And I also disclose that Queens College CUNY is funded in this budget. My son actually just graduated, so I don't know if I have to do that anymore, but I will, just to be careful. And also to disclose that my son, my wife, and myself are volunteers with TSQ Incorporated. So thank you all, and thank you for the extended time to talk about my two heroes.
Councilmember Barron.
Billy, it seems like she's back.
Yes, I was calling her for a clarification. Council Member Barron?
Yes, I want now?
Yes.
Yes, thank you. I want to correct for the record, the bill that I'm voting against is about the fuel cells, Bill 1982. So please make that correction for me. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Holden.
Before I vote, I'd like to disclose that my son is an adjunct lecturer at CUNY. And I just want to echo Barry's eloquent, just his words of we're all sorry to see certainly Claire Shulman leave us. She appointed me to the community board in 1988, and the rest is history. You had a great run. She was a great, great leader. And we all are going to miss her. She was tremendous. And I just want to echo Barry's words. I vote aye on all. Thank you.
Kalos.
I vote aye on all with the exception of introduction 1982.
I'm sorry, Councilmember. One last time. I'm sorry. I missed the last part.
I vote aye on all with the exception of introduction 1982.
Thank you. King. Councilmember King.
Sorry about that. I'm no unmuted problem. Now. I said 1199 child care fund is being funded in the resolution. For the record, my wife, Neva Schillenfer King, works for 1199 SEIU, and I vote aye on all.
Thank you. Councilmember Koo.
I vote aye on all.
Kozlowitz.
May I be excused to explain my vote?
Yes.
Barry laid out what Claire had what Claire has done for Queens. Whenever you ride around Queens, you see Claire's imprint. I was fortunate enough to serve with Claire in 1991 through 2001. Claire was elected in 1986 when we still had a Board of Estimates, and at that time was picked by the Queens delegation of the City Council. And what a great pick that was. Claire will be missed. She worked until a month before she died. She was always there for everybody who needed her. She loved Queens like no other. I was also very fortunate to be Claire's friend. And I am going to miss our dinners, our lunches that we had with the Borough Hall staff. I'm going to miss her terribly. It's a very, very sad time in Queens at the loss of Claire Shulman. Also, I want to recognize Nettie Mayerson, who was also a friend and who we had dinners with many, many times. Nettie was a fighter. She fought for the baby AIDS bill. She took nothing for granted. She fought whoever didn't want it. She was a wonderful, great woman and a legislature. So I will miss them very, very much. Thank you, and I vote aye on all.
Thank you. Councilmember Lantzman.
Aye.
Lander.
Request permission to explain.
Commissioner Granite.
Thank you. I'll be voting no on intro 1982. Last year when this council passed local law 97, our greener buildings law, a Green New Deal for New York City, we took a great step forward. And I think it's unfortunate that we are undermining it today. Our advocates in that process are asking us not to do this. And I think we should heed them. I hope we will take up intro 1947. Which can actually help us in many, many other ways, extend local law 97, and really strengthen our city's bold commitment to cleaner buildings, to cleaner energy, to a city that'll be here for our kids and grandkids. I do want to underline that I'm enthusiastically voting yes on intro 1851, which I think is a really big deal. So I want to appreciate the sponsor, Councilmember Constantinides, and all the staff who worked to get there. This bill will empower DEP to issue the 2021 Unified Stormwater Rule, which is a really ambitious rule for cleaning up our harbors and our waterways, of course, in my district, including the Gowanus Canal, and making it so that new development actually can result in cleaner water. And it's a real significant step forward. I'll be voting aye on all of the other bills, and I just want to add my voice in appreciation of the words of Councilmember Carnegie. You know, we just have too many times in these meetings had to say to our Black colleagues, we see you, and can only begin to imagine the pain it feels to come to these meetings in the wake of yet another killing. Too long, too long, too long. I vote aye on all, except for intro 1982, on which I vote no. Thank you.
Councilmember Levin.
I vote aye on all, and I want to offer my condolences to my friends and colleagues, Councilmember Combo, Councilmember Cabrera, Councilmember Grodenchik. My son is messing with my iPad here. I need to disclose on the record that my wife is a student at CUNY, and CUNY is funded in this budget. I'd like to sign up for general discussion as well at this time. And just one thing I just want to say to Councilmember Grudenchik and Councilmember Kozlowicz, I never met Claire Shulman, but for some reason, I don't know why, she was in my dream last night. So I don't know why that was, but maybe that means she's with us in some way. So with that, I vote aye on all. Thank you all.
Levine.
Thank you. I'd like to disclose
in the record that CUNY and the Department of Education are in this reso, and my sons are students at both, and I'll be voting aye on all.
Lewis.
Voting aye on all, and wanted to extend my heartfelt condolences to all my colleagues who lost loved ones. Thank you.
Mizell. Menchaca.
Permission to explain my vote?
Commissioner Grant?
Thank you. I'm going to be voting aye on all except intro 1982. I stand with my colleagues who are connecting us to that moment when we passed Local Law 97 with the advocates' support. And the exemptions that are being asked for right now are not needed. There's no need for there to be a separate factor for fuel cells, and there's no need to give special exemptions to developers or corporations selling this technology. Intro 1982 undermines our city's efforts to transition to renewable energy and mitigate the potentially devastating effects of climate change locally. By creating a separate emissions factor for natural gas fuel cells, Intro 1982 circumvents experts of the advisory board process of decision-making for Local Law 97. This process is integral into the fair and equitable implementation of that local law that we passed. Natural gas is a dirty and harmful energy source that our city should be moving away from whenever and wherever possible, not facilitating its use and distribution. Experts have shown that the level of emissions produced by fuel cells would be tantamount to burning an equal amount of natural gas in the combustion process. And gas production, including the process of fracking, creates massive amounts of methane, a greenhouse gas that is 82 times more potent than carbon and stays in the atmosphere for 12 years, just the amount of time in which we must transition to renewable energy in order to mitigate climate catastrophe that we all talk about. And for those reasons, I vote no on intro 1982 and aye on the rest. Thank you.
Councilmember Miller.
Good afternoon. I'd first like to disclose on the record that Alpha Phi Alpha Senior Center is in today's resolution, and my mother attends Alpha Phi Alpha Senior Center. I'd like to also send my condolences to my colleagues, Council Members Cabrero and Majority Leader Cumbro, on the loss of their moms, as well as two phenomenal women who happen to be legislators from the borough of Queens, Nettie Myerson and borough president Claire Schulman, who was inspiration and just to everyone in the borough, and their work will last a lifetime. I want to join my colleague Robert Cornegie, and I will be foregoing my vote this afternoon. Procedures. The work that we do here is critically important, but today it pales in comparison to what's happening across America. And I think that we have to do something to collectively lift our voices to get beyond where we thought we were and really make a difference. So with that, I'll be foregoing my vote.
Moya.
I vote aye.
Perkin. Councilmember Perkins.
Oh, I have to, you are unmuted. I don't
know. You're unmuted, Councilmember Perkins.
All right, so you've heard my vote.
No, not yet.
No, sir.
I'm voting aye on all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Powers.
I'm voting aye on all except for 1982, and I just want to briefly say a very big thank you to my outgoing committee counsel, Alana Sivin, who has been outstanding in the few years she's been here with us, has done great work, whether it's the Rikers plan, but really more transformative vision for the criminal justice system here in New York City. So you'll be deeply missed, but best of luck. And I want to say thank you for all of her work, and I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Richard.
Permission to explain my vote.
Permission granted.
All right, thank you. First, want to start off by, of course, remembering Claire Shulman, who really became a really good friend of mine. Barry and I had the blessing of attending her funeral last week, and I'm going to forever miss her and appreciate her, all of her guidance and support and all she did for Queens. Love you forever, Claire Shulman. I also just want to briefly discuss Intro 1958, which is my bill to require the Department of Small Business Services to disclose how their grants and loans are distributed by zip code. The report will identify businesses based on industry, the types of goods and services offered, and whether the business occupies a storefront or is a mobile business. It will also identify the type of award each business received, whether it was a grant or loan, and the amount each business received. Based on the information we already have, it's obvious that businesses in Manhattan were prioritized while the outer borough small businesses were neglected through this loans and grants program. This story continues to repeat itself, and only transparency and accountability will end this cycle. Queens is the second largest contributor to our city's economy. The majority of small business owners in our borough were built by immigrants who put everything into the promise of the American dream and invested in our city. We cannot turn our backs on them now. With that being said, I urge all my colleagues to vote aye on that bill and to vote no, and I will vote no on 1982. Aye on the rest. Thank you.
Rivera.
Permission to explain my vote?
Permission granted.
Thank you. When the Climate Mobilization Act passed, our goal was to reduce New York City's greenhouse gas emissions in the most aggressive way possible to meet what is essentially a global emergency. And while natural gas fuel cells emit fewer greenhouse gases than traditional fossil fuels, they are emissions nonetheless. This amendment just doesn't seem worth the risk of slowing any progress towards achieving the aggressive and necessary goals of our landmark climate laws. Therefore, I vote no on Intro 1982 and aye on all others. And I just want to say to my colleagues, I want to express my sincere condolences. Just yesterday, I heard some great stories about Claire and Nettie, and it's always heartbreaking to lose people who certainly inspired. Thank you.
Councilmember Rodriguez. Come back. Councilmember Rose.
I'd like to disclose for the record that my son is employed by the Department of Sanitation, which is being funded in this rezo. And my sincere condolences and prayers to my colleagues who have suffered such great losses. And I vote aye.
Rosenthal.
I vote aye on all.
Salamanca.
Yes, thank you. I'm disclosing on the record that the New York City Parks and Recreation is funded in this resolution, and my wife is affiliated with this entity, and I vote aye on all.
Torres.
Yes, I would like to disclose that my brother is affiliated with the Department of Finance, and I vote aye on all.
Traeger.
Permission to explain my vote.
Permission granted.
Thank you, public advocate. I want to first disclose on the record that the New York City Education Department is funded in this budget, and my father is affiliated with this entity. I also want to extend my condolences and sympathies to all of my colleagues who have experienced tragic losses in their families, and truly, truly sorry for your loss. I also just want to speak very briefly about the issues of school reopening and take off my councilmember hat on off and put my teacher hat on for a moment and share with my colleagues. And I think Councilmember Drum and others who have taught, Councilmember Rodriguez, Ravine, others, that before you can ask a student to open a notebook in a class, you have to first establish trust. And you have to first establish a safe and supportive learning environment for our kids. And if you can't promise them that, and you can't establish that trust, then you can't look them in the eye and tell them it's okay. And as public advocate, you know, tells us, we have to speak truth to that type of power. And it's not okay for our kids right now and for our staff, especially after what we saw yesterday. I think our kids and staff deserve better and more than just toilet paper waving in the air in a class. It's as if the mayor's plan or inadequate plan was written on a piece of toilet paper and he's just winging it. And I know the public advocate, and I appreciate his leadership as well, shared a similar proposal to mine about delaying the reopening to get money to operationalize safety plans and have a phased in approach. And I asked my colleagues to center the needs of our kids and staff in this very important conversation. And with that, I will vote aye and all. Thank you. Vallone.
I'd like to vote aye on all, but I also need to disclose on the record that Citizen Schools is in the rezzo. My father and brother are associated with this entity, and my condolences to all who have experienced a loss. God bless everyone, and good luck with this Labor Day coming up. Thank you.
Councilmember Rodriguez.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Van Bramer.
Permission to explain my vote.
Mr. Grant.
Thank you very much. First, condolences to all of our colleagues who've lost family members, particularly moms. As many folks know, as we work and spend a lot of time with my mother in these days of difficulty, I certainly feel for them deeply. I am voting no on intro 1982. As several of my colleagues have said, Local Law 97 was a huge step forward. I do not know why we would start rolling it back, particularly so soon when the global climate crisis is only increasing and not decreasing. So especially with the advocates who fought so hard with and for Local Law 97, why we would do this when they are not for it, it makes no sense. So I am voting no on Local Law 1982 because the crisis is real and this is not helpful. And I vote yes on all the rest. Thank you.
Excuse me, Councilmember Yeager.
Thank you. Mr. President, may I be excused to explain my vote?
Permission granted.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I appreciate all the work that has been put into making it easier for our restaurants to do business in the city. I'll speak a little bit more about that during the next period. Our restaurants are suffering tremendously, and the piecemeal approach of trying to give them the ability to open up on the streets. It works sometimes, it doesn't work other times. It certainly doesn't work when it rains. And as we approach September and quickly into October, that's not going to be a permanently workable solution. I think there ought to be a time that we seriously begin talking about allowing restaurants to have some capacity indoors, perhaps not 100, but we're seeing restaurants in the Bronx where patrons can simply
jump over the border into Westchester and go into a restaurant, and the same in Queens where they could jump over the border into Nassau and eat in a restaurant. And here in New York City, it just can't be done. If a restaurant can seat 100 people, can 10% not safely sit inside? It's a serious conversation. It shouldn't be done in 2 minutes by me, but it's something that we ought to be talking about over the next few weeks. With that, though, I typically, as my colleagues here know, I have a great reluctance to voting for bills that I believe hinder the performance of contracts. I think it violates the Constitution. I think this is a close call, but on this close call, seeing as it will pass anyway, I will stick with my gut. I will vote aye on all with the exception of introductions 2043 and 2054, on which I vote no, and I abstain on resolution 1394. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Nadio.
I'm disclosing on the record that PS30 is in this resolution. My sons attend PS30. I'm voting no on pre-considered 2043 and 2054, and aye on the rest. Thank you.
Speaker Johnson.
I vote aye on all.
Okay, the vote on all items for today's general order calendar is 47 in the affirmative, 0 in the negative, and no abstentions, with the exceptions of the following. Introduction 1982A with 38 in the affirmative, 9 in the negative, no abstentions. Introduction 2043 with 44 in the affirmative, 3 in the negative, no abstentions. Introduction 2054 with 44 in the affirmative, 3 in the negative, no abstentions. Land use items 628 and 629 with their accompanying resolutions are 46 in the affirmative, 1 in the negative, no abstentions. Resolution 1394 with 46 in the affirmative, 0 in the negative, 1 abstention. And finally, the revised land use call up is now 47 in the affirmative and 0 in the negative. Thank you.
Thank you. The items on today's general orders are calendar are adopted. I want to thank my colleagues for voting on my bill. I forgot to thank the speaker when I spoke for him and Jason Goldman and the entire team for moving quickly on the construction site bill based on the deadline we were up against. So I just want to make sure I said thank you. Introduction and reading of bills.
All bills have been referred to committees as indicated on today's agenda.
Thank you, Speaker Johnson. There are no resolutions on today's calendar, so we'll now move into general order discussion. As a reminder, please wait until the Sergeant of Arms begins the countdown clock before you begin your remarks. So remember, when you get called on, the Sergeant of Arms will begin the countdown clock. Wait for that so you don't lose any seconds. Then you can begin your remarks. Mr. Parliamentarian, are there any council members or sign up to speak?
Yes, council members Adams, Powers, and Yeager are the first three.
So we have Councilmember Adams, Councilman Powers, and Councilmember Yeager, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Public Advocate. Thank you so much. First, to acknowledge our loss of the original Queen of Queens, Claire Shulman, who always had a word of inspiration and a big hug for me. We're going to miss her dearly. Mr. Public Advocate, I'd like to thank you for your heartfelt words, as well as the heartfelt words of my colleagues, Councilmember Cornegie and Councilmember Miller, on the plight of Black people in America, which I think is an interesting backdrop to the resolution that I'm introducing today. I'm introducing Resolution 1387 in support of the New York State Senate Bill S8921 to postpone the New York City 2020 tax lien sale until 1 year after the COVID-19 state of emergency has been lifted. While the mayor delayed the 2020 lien sale, it doesn't go far enough. COVID-19 has disrupted the lives of New Yorkers and has put financial pressures on residents across this city. Many have lost their jobs or their businesses and are struggling to make ends meet. The only way to equitable recovery for New Yorkers is to cancel the 2020 lien sale. The mayor claimed this week that property owners facing tax lien sales were in trouble with their bills before the pandemic. Unfortunately, due to COVID-19, appropriate outreach on outstanding debts was impossible. Also, how can vulnerable New Yorkers possibly enter a payment plan at this time if they're unemployed or have been devastated financially because of the pandemic? I'm deeply disturbed by the cruelty that the lien sale will serve to hardworking 1-3 family homeowners still struggling to recover from the mortgage foreclosure crisis and realize the American dream. Housing instability was a major problem in New York City before the pandemic, and moving forward with the 2020 lien sale will only exacerbate that fact. If passed, the Senate's bill would help many who are struggling, particularly in communities of color. I ask my colleagues to show your support by signing on to Resolution 1387. Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate.
Thank you, Councilmember Powers, followed by Councilmember Yeager.
Thank you. And I'll just mention that that dovetails well with a resolution that myself and the public advocate have, which is to call off any rent increases for rent regulated units during the pandemic and in the coming year. Thank you, the public advocate, for your sponsorship. I'll let Councilmember Levin talk about the bill, but I'll just briefly mention that we have a bill that's going in today, which is around folks essentially banning the box for housing so that landlords can no longer ask or inquire about a person's conviction history when we're talking about finding housing, something that would be an incredible benefit to ending the prison to shelter pipeline and helping folks get housing that is much needed. But I'll let Councilmember Levin talk more about that. I have a few bills and resolutions. I just want to mention one that is it went in today that is related to the Heck-Calandra Act, which calls on the state to repeal the Heck-Calandra Act, which is related to specialized high schools, give us authority in the city of New York City to have control over our own specialized and public high schools. A second one is to ask the Department of Education to call off lateness and absences as a metric when you're doing screens, admissions to screen schools. What we find, and COVID is a great example of this, is that parents are sometimes required to send their kid to school to make sure that they are not penalized in the admissions process. That means when we have a flu epidemic or in the COVID in particular, parents have to weigh out whether it is worth sending their child to school just to get attendance and not to be penalized in admissions for middle school and high school. So those are two resolutions going in and two bills going in. One is to require the Department of Corrections to publish all its directives and guidelines and rules on their website so the public has access to that information. No different than the way the NYPD's rules and guides are also required to be published online. And second is a new law that would actually require whistleblower, sorry, city contracts, large city contracts to be incorporated into the city whistleblower law. Right now it's in their city contracts, but it's not actual law, where if you are have a large contract with the city of New York, that if you are now, you would now be subject to the city's whistleblower law as in their contract.
I'm expired.
Would ask all folks to consider signing on to those and appreciate everybody's support. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Yeager.
Time starts.
Thank you, Mr. President. Before I begin, I just want to add my voice to Councilmember Adams' resolution. It's just another time when it becomes very evident to us that sometimes we need the folks in the state legislature to save us from ourselves. And this is just another time we're simply calling on them to help us out here in the city. This is a way that they can do it very easily. I am speaking today on something similar to what my two colleagues just spoke about. Many members of this body have spoken passionately over the last few weeks, months, about ways that we as the people's representatives can guide our city towards helping instead of hurting our fellow New Yorkers. And we've had energetic discussion about our children's education, assistance to small business, rent payers, taxpayers, the burdensome regulations that are keeping our businesses from being able to recover, to reopen, our neighbors' inability to pay rent, the punishing pain of poverty and food insecurity, healthcare, our municipal employees, the size and role of government, and how we can do better for the people who sent us here. Today, I hope to continue that
with the introduction of Intro 2069. My bill would suspend the issuance of certain sanitation, parking, and building summonses and the imposition of penalties retroactive to the beginning of the state of emergency in March. From the very beginning of the state of emergency, when people were being urged to remain at home, indoors, don't go out. If you must go out, make it brief, never leave, only wear a mask, never leave, stay inside. Unsuspecting New Yorkers park their cars at parking spots on the assumption that if you park in front of a public school that's closed, you won't receive a summons because the public school is closed. And then they showed up at that car 2, 3, 4, 5 weeks later, only to find that car covered with summonses. Similarly, when we were telling people to stay indoors, the sanitation department was sending enforcement agents out. Mr. President, my time is going to expire. I ask for a couple more seconds. The Department of Sanitation was sending enforcement agents out to write summonses on homeowners who didn't go out to sweep the front of their homes, even though the department itself was not sending out street cleaners. This bill would finally address that punishing pain. The punishing pain of summonses is punishing during normal times, and these are not normal times. Fairness and reason require a holiday from this punishment. I would urge you all, please join me, sign on to Introduction 2069. Let this be part of the relief that we're offering our neighbors to recover from this pandemic. Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, for the additional time.
Thank you. Mr. Parliamentarian?
Yes, first, as a point of parliamentary order, I'd like to read the revised results of the land use call-up calendar, which are 48 in the affirmative, 0 in the negative, and 0 abstentions. And with that, Mr. Public Advocate, I'll let you know all of the council members who wish to speak at this point, who are council members Rose, Lander, King, Barron, and Levin.
Just so I got it right, Rose, Lander, King, Barron, and Levin. Is that correct?
Yes, and please add Councilmember Menchaca at the end.
Councilman Menchaca.
He just signed up.
I believe we may have some after, but for now, we'll have Councilmember Rose, followed by Councilmember Lander, King, Barron, Levin, and Menchaca.
Time begins.
Thank you. Yes, we're speaking to two bills that I've introduced, which will help the city better serve the survivors of those who have died in the COVID pandemic. Intro 2063 would require that the city's Department of Mental Hygiene release monthly numbers aggregated by borough, how many have lost parents, legal guardians, or caretakers to COVID-19. Children who have lost parents to this disease are likely to need support services, and it is important that we meet those needs. But the first step in doing so is to collect accurate data. We will use this data to coordinate with city agencies and identify what supportive service programs need additional funding. These children are suffering losses, and we need to equip our agencies with the right tools. Intro 2062 would require DOHMH to fulfill death benefit requests from the borough's public administrator's office on an expedited basis. Under the current policy, public administrators' offices have had to retrieve death certificates in person or wait as long as 9 months for electronic. Public administrators are responsible for administering the estates and making burial for those who have died relatives present to make arrangements. In order to make these arrangements and protect these estates, a death certificate is necessary. The lack of an expedited process for securing death certificates can result in waste of an estate and reduction of assets distributed at the final accounting. So just to give you an idea, the Richmond County Public Administrator's Office arranged 41 burials in all of 2019. And as of today, they've already arranged 53 burials. So I'm asking on that. And I just want to, just another second, to say that I joined my colleague Mark Traeger in the introduction of Rezo that calls for the Department of Education to delay the reopening of public schools until the safety standards for our children and staff have been met. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Lander, followed by Councilmember King, Barron, Levin, and Menchaca.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate. I want to invite my colleagues to join Council Members Rivera, Torres, Barron, Powers, Reynoso, and me in signing on to Resolution 1397, calling on the New York City Department of Education to prohibit the use of screens for admissions to our community district middle schools for the 2021-22 school year. Boy, there's always something wrong with sorting our 8 and 9 and 10-year-olds based on test scores and attendance and grades and sorting their life chances in a way that we know produces segregation. And really, you can't argue that we should have a meritocracy of 8 and 9 and 10-year-olds. But I gotta say, for this year especially, even if that's not what you usually think, I'd like to just ask you to think about what it means to try to take test scores and grades and attendance records from last spring, from the pandemic spring semester, which was totally disrupted. There is no meaningful data there. We can't in good conscience sort our middle school kids based on that meaningless semester. We've got this great model in District 15 that is working to offer kids middle school admissions based on a weighted lottery where families get to rank their schools and where then you hold the lottery based on what those kids want in a way that reflects the balance of kids throughout the community school district. It's working for this one year, for this pandemic year. If you say that you're seeing the racial inequities and segregation that are coursing through our city, let's try it. We've got to make a decision right now. There's no way just to go with the status quo. So I hope you'll sign on to Resolution 1397. And I look forward to signing on to Councilmember Adams' resolution about the tax lien sale, and proud to join Councilmembers Powers and Levin in many of the resolutions that they're introducing today. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember King, followed by Councilmember Barron, Levin, and Menchaca.
Time begins.
Councilmember King? Councilmember King,
Can you hear me now?
Yep.
Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate. I appreciate the time. First, I want to lend my voice also to Councilmember Traeger. I believe that, as the Chancellor once said, you know, we're building the plane while we're flying the plane, but that can be, you can crash land at the same time. So if our schools are not ready to reopen, then I think in a matter of 2 weeks, then we should have them closed until they can figure the whole thing out correctly for our children. Secondly, I want to say to Councilmember Adams, I support the resolution, as my district is number 10 with tax liens on the market. We need to make sure that we keep homeowners safe, and more importantly, keep our neighborhood stable. And this is no way in the time of pandemic to try to figure out how to, you know, stick people up for money. Let's wait until we get through this and then start it all over the process. And finally, I'd like to ask everyone to join Councilmember Margaret Trent and I to sign on to Intro 2045, which creates a centurion bill, which came out of a 103-year-old resident getting there, losing all their benefits because they didn't meet a recertification. They didn't go to an appointment. Absurd. So this bill designs a unit in the Department of Aging to make sure that that unit is responsible for any recertification, any services, state, city level, that any 80-year-old is receiving in the city of New York. They no longer have to go through the recertification process. We know seniors are vital to our community. They're our mothers, they're our grandparents, and no way in this time during a pandemic. I know they're having challenges. They're telling me our challenges that they're having to try to maintain services. That's why it's so important that we establish this unit, that they come out and visit, do wellness checks, and make sure all documents is necessary, that no senior over 80 years of age needs to do recertification process. I ask you, Speaker Johnson, it's 120 days after this bill is passed that it goes into effect. I ask us if we can fast track, speed it up, because our seniors cannot wait in this time and age of what we're dealing with, COVID and all other issues of communication, that we need to do it right and do it quick and fast as possible. I thank you. Look for everyone signing on to make sure we protect our mothers, our grandmothers, our grandparents, and the matriarchs of our community. Thank you.
Sorry, Councilmember Barron, followed by Councilmember Levin and Menchaca.
Time begins.
Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate. I want to thank my colleagues for all of their comments and all of their thoughtful reflection. I want to encourage you to join Councilmember Powers and I as we present the resolution to have the Assembly repeal the Hecht Calendra Act and allow the city to establish how we will have our students selected for going into our high schools. Secondly, I want to support the comments of Councilmember Adams. talking about the lien sale and the hardship that it causes. And to get to the heart of what I want to talk about today, after slavery was so-called ended and we came to a period of reconstruction, shortly thereafter, because of the pushback, the United States pulled the protections and the troops and the programs out from the South, and they in fact returned to what had been in large measure. When the Hebrew Israelites came out of the oppression and were scouting out the land that God had promised to them, they became afraid and they pulled back. They said, we're grasshoppers, we don't think we can do it. So what was their entitlement, they didn't get for at least another 40 years. I think it's a reflection that sometimes people doubt their own self-worth. So here we have just passed a bill that says to police officers, no, you cannot kill us. You cannot restrict our breathing either by stepping on our necks, stepping on our backs, or stepping on our diaphragms. And there is pushback. I don't care who says what. This is coming not from advocates, but from people in the police quarters who want to be able to do their job with impunity because they don't have consequences. So I'm opposed to this. You know, Lonnie Glenier talked about authentic leadership.
I'm expired.
Thank you, almost finished. Dr. Martin Luther King talked about manufactured leaders. So we're looking to see which of our leaders are going to act authentically on behalf of our people or be persuaded by other entities to pull back and give back what we have already accomplished without any justification for considering that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilmember. Councilmember Levin, followed by Councilmember Menchaca.
Thank you very much, Mr. Public Advocate. So I just want to follow up on what Councilmember Powers mentioned earlier. Today, I'm very proud to be introducing the Fair Chance for Housing Act for New York City. This bill would ban background checks and make it illegal to deny a person housing because of their conviction history. Our city is grappling with a global pandemic with historic economic impacts. Already, New Yorkers are facing a housing crisis. With record job loss and instability, we need even greater access to deeply affordable housing, and we need to remove the barriers that have kept too many New Yorkers from having a safe and stable home for far too long. Tens of thousands of New Yorkers living in city shelters are unable to find permanent housing. Many have convictions that make the already daunting search for affordable housing in New York City almost impossible. Formerly incarcerated individuals are nearly 10 times more likely to be homeless than the general public, often because of discriminatory practices by real estate agents, landlords, and others. In 2017, over half of the people paroled from New York State prisons went directly to homeless shelters. That is an increase of 23% from 3 years earlier. We need to stop the prison-to-shelter pipeline and to end the use of discriminatory background checks in housing. Housing is a fundamental human right. Having a safe, stable home is a critical foundation for success after arrest or incarceration. It increases an individual's ability to maintain employment and foster supportive relationships, both of which contribute to greater public safety and lower taxpayer costs. Other cities have passed similar legislation, including San Francisco, Richmond, and Seattle, and have proven that banning criminal background checks does not pose a risk to public safety. I'm very proud to sponsor this common sense legislation along with my council colleagues, Councilmembers Powers, Lander, Carnegie, Rivera, Councilmember Gibson, and Public Advocate Williams. I look forward to moving this urgently needed bill forward. And I urge all of my colleagues to sign on. And I also want to just thank the advocates that have helped draft or helped work on this legislation. And that's Fortune Society, John Jay College for Institute of Justice and Opportunity, Osborne Association, Exodus, Center for Community Alternatives, and many others. Thank you to Balkis Mirig, Committee Council for drafting the legislation. I want to thank all of you. I appreciate the time. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Menchaca.
Time begins.
Thank you, Public Advocate, and thank you to all my colleagues who are introducing some really great bills. And I want to talk about two bills that I'm introducing today, really from the many ideas that have come from the community, specifically our immigrant community. Intro 2053 is a really important bill. At this time, our city has seen a sharp increase in immigration and customs enforcement arrests and deportations in New York City. In Sunset Park specifically, we are and have been targeted. Just last week, we had ICE presence in the neighborhood. Many of these arrests are done under the cover of darkness and secrecy. This is Trump's effort to intimidate our immigrant neighbors and undermine our status as a sanctuary city. It's also having an impact on our census response rate, COVID testing, and they are also, as immigrant families leaving programs, for example, food programs, that are leaving our families hungry. That is why I'm introducing this bill to empower people to hold accountable the federal government and to keep an eye on ICE violation of constitutional rights. Under this bill, any New Yorker can report ICE activity. This will allow council members, each of you in your district, to keep track and respond effectively to keep constituents apprised of any issues and connecting people to legal services that are paid for by the city of New York. I'm also introducing Reso 1399. Under federal law, states are prohibited from providing certain benefits to undocumented immigrants, including financial assistance that people critically need to deal with during a crisis like the one that we're experiencing now. Federal law, however, does provide an exemption, namely that states can pass legislation like New York to allow our cities and the state itself to grant benefits. The council, I'm hoping, can support this resolution to push the state to really unlock opportunities for undocumented immigrants.
I'm expired.
Have access to those benefits that we've seen thus far. Thank you so much, and look forward to working with you.
Thank you, Mr. Parliamentarian. Do we have anyone else that signed up?
No, we do not.
Thank you. Just very briefly, I want to just say thank you to Councilman Powers and Levin for bringing up the fair housing legislation. I'm happy to join them on that. I want to thank Councilman Matrega for his leadership when it comes to reopening, and we both submitted similar plans in the phased reopening. I want to thank him for a bill that we're introducing today, asking folks to please join us in supporting the bill. So getting a report on a regular basis about the attendance of students remotely. We should be treating that just the same as we're treating in person. And we don't want to use that data punitively. We want to use that data so we can find out where the problems are and get the resources that are needed to make sure that folks are getting the education they need. There's also another bill that will require a food policy and plan for any schools that have to close for any reason to make sure that people who are depending on it to get food will get it. So I'm asking my colleagues to please join me in those bills that are being introduced today. So with that, I want to say also just also my prayers of peace and comfort to colleagues, Councilman Cabrera, and of course, Majority Leader for their loss, and all the friends and families who spoke about Claire Showman and Nettie Meyerson. With that, thank you so much. And I'll now turn over to Speaker Curry Johnson, who will close today's state meeting. You're on mute, Speaker.
Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate. And thank you to everyone for today's stated meeting. Congratulations to all of our colleagues who passed these bills. And I again want to send my condolences to folks who lost loved ones. And with that, the stated meeting of August 27th, 2020 is now adjourned.